friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear.
Baptizing, anything you'd like to say about it, Sherry?
It won't save you.
No, water baptism won't. Being baptized by the Holy Spirit will.
Yeah, that's different.
Yeah. And they really don't go into a big discussion. They've entitled it Baptizing because this Ethiopian eunuch who was in charge of the treasury of the queen, Candace, was not her name. It was more or less a title, kind of like Caesar was. When you read the Roman stuff, Caesar was not the guy's name. It was more or less a title. But this guy was in charge of the entire treasury, so he's a very important person, probably very wealthy because he's reading Scripture. Scripture was very hard to come by. All Scripture back in those days had to be hand copied. So this guy somehow must have had money in order to buy a copy of the Scripture, and he was reading it. But Philip has been led by the Spirit of God to go down to a kind of a deserted area where this guy's going to be traveling. The guy decides to become a follower of Jesus Christ and wants to get baptized. The passages of Scripture that they were studying from out of the book of Isaiah, and I'm going to say this with certainty, the passages of Scripture that they were studying from out of the book of Isaiah did not say anything about baptism. Now, how can I make that assertion that those passages that they were studying out of the book of Isaiah did not say anything about baptism? And what were you saying?
It was in the Old Testament before John, Jesus died.
Okay, both of you ladies have hit upon it, and I hope that you understand this. Baptism is not mentioned at all in the Old Testament. Never. You don't find baptism until the New Testament with John the Baptist. So even though this guy is reading from the book of Isaiah, and he's reading from Isaiah chapter 53, the suffering servant, you know, where Jesus is led like a lamb to the slaughter and so on and so forth, the passage of Scripture, we honestly as Christians believe it's describing Jesus Christ. And this guy is asking, you know, is this about the prophet, or is it about who? And Philip says, no, it's talking about this guy that was in Jerusalem. His name was Jesus. And so somehow during the conversation must have got over onto the issue of baptism. Now all that we can do is speculate how they made the transition. But here's the one thing I'll say about the lesson. It does not, even though it's entitled Baptizing, it does not take you to passages of Scripture that really talk about baptism. Now, it may reference them. One of the ones that's referenced, and you may need your Bible today, because we're going to take a look at it, Romans chapter 6. Here's what I'm going to emphasize with today's lesson about baptism. Even though this guy was not studying anything from out of the book of Isaiah about baptism, when Philip talked with him and said, those that are followers of this man that's being described in the book of Isaiah, in Isaiah 53, that is about Jesus, you know, that he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement for our peace was upon him. You know, that's the passage of Scripture that he's basically studying. Philip tells him this is about Jesus, and those that are followers of his really should be baptized. So here's what I'm trying to emphasize. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, you really need to be baptized. And this guy took that seriously. I mean, I don't know how this guy was dressed. I'll say this much about people. I don't believe that people's character has changed at all in human history. I think the things that we are concerned about today, they were concerned about, you say, where are you going with this? This was a high-ranking official. He probably looked nice. Probably probably had good clothes. In fact, the book talks about that he's, because he's in charge of the treasury, he probably has a lot of servants and so on and so forth. This guy says, let's stop the chariot right here and let me go down and get baptized. I don't think there were changing rooms out there. Maybe I'm wrong, but I could envision this man dressed in his nice robes and everything else. He said, I'm not putting this off. I've got an opportunity to identify with Jesus Christ, to be baptized, stop the chariot. I don't care what I look like or what people think about me. I'm going to get baptized. I've run into, during the course of my ministry, not a lot, people that are reluctant to get baptized. In fact, two of the most recent ones, Ron Taylor. I don't know that Gene was so much, but Ron especially, he didn't like the idea of going underwater. Feels claustrophobic, you know. And I understand people may have reasons why not. But again, the point that I'm going to say with today's lesson, this man, after talking with Philip, said, I really need to get this done. And I'm sure that he wasn't dressed for the occasion. You know, when we have baptism, I tell people to wear some other clothes and so on. I can imagine this guy continuing on his journey, you know, looking like a drowned rat. He'd say, it probably didn't matter. But this was a high rank. He was in charge of the entire treasury. And he didn't care about what anybody else thought about him. He said, I'm going to get baptized. Stop the chariot. I've oftentimes wondered, too. I know that they say that along that route there were several springs. But I wondered, it's a desert road. Where in the world are you going to find water? And if you do find water, is it going to be kind of stagnant? But apparently they say that there were some springs along that road, so I take that it was somewhat fresh. I only mentioned that about stagnant water. Stagnant water stinks. But this guy, so here's what I'm going to say. I have run into people that are reluctant to get baptized. And when you read stories like this, you can see the importance. I think that in one of the two books it talked about in some countries, it's almost like signing your death warrant. That the people will go to get baptized and they're actually spies on the bank to see whether or not you've converted from like Islam or whatnot. And then once you become a Christian, you're either ostracized or sometimes hunted down and killed because of your faith. Baptism is not essential. Water baptism is not essential for salvation. And I know that there's Christians in the area that feel otherwise. But I believe it is symbolic.
Yeah, it's an expression of our faith in Jesus.
It is. It is. Yeah. And that's why I've had you turn to Romans
Jesus
chapter 6.
Jesus got baptized, so should we.
Not only did he get baptized, but we believe the Great Commission.
Yeah.
In Matthew chapter 28, where he's speaking to disciples following his resurrection. He's at Galilee, and he said to those disciples, go ye therefore, teach all nations, doing what? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Teaching them to observe all things that I command you, and lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. So we've been commanded to baptize. But we don't feel like that it's essential because there are people in the Bible that were not baptized. The thief on the cross is the one that's... Jesus said to that thief on the cross who was not baptized, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. See, it's the faith.
That's because he believed in
Jesus. It's the faith in Jesus
Christ. And he knew who he was, that he knew that was the Messiah.
Absolutely.
And the other one on the other side was kind of mocking and making fun. And he said, don't you realize who this really is?
Yep, the one thief was making fun of Jesus. And, you know, if you really are the Son of God, come down off the cross, save yourself and save us. And the other thief rebukes this thief that's making fun. He says, hey, lay off of him. We're getting what we deserve. This man hasn't done anything. And following his rebuke of this other thief, he says to Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, would you remember me? And Jesus says, yes, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. So it's this faith in Jesus Christ. It's not the water baptism. But we believe that what happens when you have, and I'm going to use this word, saving faith, when you are willing to entrust Jesus Christ with your salvation, that the Holy Spirit not only comes in to change your heart, but the Holy Spirit marks you with a seal. It talks about Ephesians chapter 1, that you have been with a seal that God recognizes. I use in saying to people, it's like a brand, that God has basically branded you. You can look at that if you want to see. I've had you turn to Romans chapter 6. We'll get to that in a second. We can go back to the one in Ephesians. But anyhow, the subject today is about baptism. It's just that the passage of Scripture, other than talking about the fact that this man was baptized, it really doesn't give in a lot of details about what baptism is all about. That's why I've had you turn to Romans chapter 6, and hopefully we get a chance to go and look at that. So do you have any questions? The other sub-theme of the lesson today, which is not part of the title, is following the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Because Philip has been up in the northern region of Samaria, the Holy Spirit says to him, you need to leave this area. And there's great things going on up there. There's people getting saved. And the Spirit of God says, I want you to leave this area that's being very fruitful and productive, and I want you to go down to this desert road. A desert road? You mean like a place where very few people travel? The Spirit of God says, yes, go there. And it's on this trip down there that Philip encounters this man. I believe it was a divine appointment. God wanted him to go down. We don't know the results of this treasure becoming a Christian. But I would like to believe. I mean, I wish we had like a family tree, spiritual tree, of how this guy went back and, you know, all of Northern Africa became followers of Jesus Christ. But the Spirit of God said, this person is so important. I want to leave where you're going, where you've been, and go down. So that's kind of a secondary theme of today's lesson, is that you and I need to be willing to obey the Spirit of God. That's where it gets a little bit tricky for me as a teacher. Because I can't tell you when the Spirit of God is speaking to you. You need to learn to recognize the Spirit of God speaking to your heart and your life. And that comes through faith. Right? So anyhow, let's get into today's lesson. Let's go to the passage of Scripture. First passage of Scripture. Dave, you want to get us started reading? Page 84.
Okay, intersection. An angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, get up and go south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is the desert road. So he got up and went. There was an Ethiopian man, a eunuch, and a high official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to worship in Jerusalem, and was sitting in his chariot on his way home, reading the prophet Isaiah aloud. The Spirit told Philip, go and join that chariot.
Okay, let's get back to that first verse where it talks about the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip and said, get up and go south the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is the desert road. Let's talk briefly about the Spirit of God leading us. There are a couple of other stories that kind of stick in my mind about the Spirit of God leading people. One would be the Apostle Paul when he was in Troas, and they had been wanting to go in one direction. The Spirit of God prevented them. It's written in the book of Acts. And that night, Paul had a vision of a man over Macedonia, which is in the opposite direction, saying, come over here. So the next day, Paul said, let's go over there to Macedonia. The reason that sticks out to me, where did Paul go in Macedonia? Do you remember the city that he went to?
Philippi.
So go on with the story. What happened when he got to Philippi? There was a great revival that was going on, right? They got to Philippi and there really wasn't anything. They'd gone down to the river to pray. There was a group of women down there. A lady, Lydia, who dealt with purple cloth.
Tent making too.
Okay? And they began to witness to Lydia. I mean, this wasn't like God saying to Paul, I want you to go over here because there's this great revival. No, he goes there and there's, from what I can see, there's really not much evidence of much happening spiritually there. So they kind of continue this thing of meeting with this woman on their travels down there every day. There was a woman that was possessed by an evil spirit that she nagged them. You remember how she nagged them? Yeah, she kept saying what? Do you remember? These men are servants of the Most High God. You need to listen to them. I mean, it doesn't sound all that offensive. I just think that it was the way that she was saying it. You know, maybe with ridicule. Well, she was possessed by an evil spirit, and her owners, because she was a slave, they made a lot of money off of her.
Yeah,
she kind of like a sorceress.
And
yeah,
she provided for her masters and then by telling fortunes and stuff.
Yep.
And they took them to court or whatever because they were caused her to
lose her
powers and stuff.
Paul cast the demon out of her.
Right, because, yeah.
He finally said, I've had enough of you, lady. Evil spirit that's prompting this lady to be a pain in my neck. Evil spirit, get out. And when the owner saw that they had lost their source of income, they took Paul and Silas, took them to court.
Because they caused them to lose their income.
Okay. And so here's where I'm going. And when they got to court, the court says, this is a frivolous lawsuit. Let them go. What happened? That's not what happened. They took Paul and Silas, they beat them within an inch of their life and threw them in an inner cell in a prison.
I was going to say, I thought they went to prison.
So, lest we lose sight of this, of what the reason I'm telling you this story, the Spirit of God has led Paul and Silas to go to this area to witness to people, and the Holy Spirit of God puts them in prison, led them to a place where they got beaten and thrown in prison. And all that I'm saying is that when I read about Philip being led by the Spirit of God to go to a desert road, I mean, stop to think about that. You think a desert road is hot? You think a desert... I just read this past week of some guy. Did he die? I can't remember if he died or not. A guy from Belgium went out to Death Valley and he wore flip-flops. And the flip-flops actually came off and he walked and he got third-degree burns on the bottom of his feet. Okay. Desert road. The Spirit of God says to Philip, and great things are going on with Philip. You go back and you read what he's been part of, kind of a revival. And the Spirit of God says, I want you to leave where things are good and go to where things are bad. That's the way I'm looking at it. Philip, to get down there, folks, he's got... I don't know how many hundred miles that he has to make that trip in order to get down there. And I don't know what he's expecting, but lo and behold, there's this guy with an entourage of people. And I don't know how you are when you get around
important people.
Yeah, good choice of words there. But my tendency would be, I'm going to kind of steer clear of them because I feel a little bit uncomfortable.
This guy, because he is such a high official, he probably has the bodyguards.
Probably so. You're exactly right. I mean, he's got an entourage.
Yeah.
I mean, he's traveling. One of the things they dealt with in those days were bandits. You know, there would be bandits that would lay alongside the road and wait for people to come out. They could jump them, and just like with the Good Samaritans.
If you look at your map, it tells you exactly where it happened.
Okay. And the map that he's talking about is in the very back of your book, inside the back cover, down in Judea, as you look at that red line, the bottom red line, it says 2 in the box, Philip baptized an Ethiopian official and explains the words of Isaiah. So it shows you, as Chuck said, it shows you basically the area that he's, and he has been, look at where Philip has been. Philip has been up in Samaria, that purple region up there. Philip has made this trip all the way down. That's a long distance. The Spirit of God has taken him from an area in which you could clearly see the Spirit of God is moving and taken him to a remote area. So as I said with Paul was on a missionary trip. He and Silas, they follow the Spirit of God. Spirit of God leads them to Philippi. Philippi, they get arrested, they get beaten. And out of that, we know that the Philippian jailer and he and his family got saved. The other story that kind of sticks in my mind about the Spirit of God, and it's maybe not so much about the Spirit of God as about Jesus himself, the story of the Gadarene demoniac. Do y'all remember any of the particulars about that story?
The what?
The Gadarene demoniac. The man that was filled with a legion of demons.
Oh,
yeah. Oh. You remember him? It's up at the Sea of Galilee.
Yeah.
And Jesus is in one area, and Jesus says to the disciples, he says, you know what? I feel impressed. We need to go across the lake. And while they're out there on the lake, a big storm comes up. Jesus has intentionally said to his disciples, there's something that needs to be done. We need to do it. They get in the boat at Jesus' command. They almost drown. A storm comes up. Jesus put his disciples at risk.
Did he?
Well,
yeah, thank you.
They thought they were there. Yeah.
If Jesus hadn't been there, I'm convinced they'd have sunk to the bottom of the sea.
Yeah.
That's what I don't see.
I'm not saying that the circumstances for them wasn't dire, but he was in the boat sleeping. So he went. Was he worried about it?
No, he wasn't. But again, I'm trying to point out that the Spirit of God sometimes leads us in situations that are not necessarily safe. They don't seem to be productive. They look like that they've got more marks against them than they've got marks going for them. And when the storm's over, they come to this coastline. They're met by this crazy man, you know, who hasn't probably shaved in years. He's running around naked. He's filled with demons. Jesus cast the demons out, you know, the demons. He calls himself Legion. Legion, by the way, is 6,000. That's what a legion was. He casts all these demons into a herd of pigs. The pigs run down the bank into the sea and they drown. And here's where I'm going with this sort of story. When you read that story, it doesn't say that Jesus had any other reason for having crossed that lake than to reach a demon-possessed crazy man. So what I'm trying to get across to you is that when the Spirit of God is... Sometimes we're motivated to do things because of what we can see with our eyes. In each of these stories, it wasn't necessarily what the people could see with their eyes. It was just, I am feeling led that this is where I need to be, regardless of what happens as a result. And in each case, I don't know what happened as a result of this Gadarene demoniac. You know, he wanted to get in the boat and go back with Jesus' disciples, and Jesus said, no. You need to stay here and bear witness to the people around here. You need to let them know what great things God has done for you. With this Ethiopian eunuch, I don't know how God ended up using him. All that I can say is that God has called each one of us into service. And I'm not trying to make it more difficult for you. Sometimes people say, well, I'm feeling led by the Lord because of how good the circumstances are. And I'm saying, being led by the Spirit of God is not dependent upon the circumstances. It's dependent upon God who knows, and only God knows, why he's called. So as I said, this is kind of a sub... I don't feel like I'm very good at teaching people about following the Spirit of God because, well, I walk by faith. But I can't answer for you. Each one of you have to walk by faith with this relationship that you have with God. I don't know how God is working within your heart and within your life. Only you do. And the more that you walk with God, I say that the more familiar you become with God and his ways, but in some ways, it requires greater faith. Because God is not asking us to do what makes sense to us. His ways are higher than our ways. And he knows. So, this Philip, he goes down there. So he got up, verse 27. He got up and went. There was an Ethiopian man. Let me just ask a quick question here. What color are most Ethiopians? And by the way, Ethiopia... in this text, is not the Ethiopia of current day over in Africa.
No.
This is kind of the northern area. what's known in the other places in the Old Testament known as Cush, all right? But probably the guy had a darker complexion. Which, by the way, why do people there have darker complexion?
More sunshine.
More pigmentation. Of course, I believe that God had created people for certain regions, but anyhow. So he got up and he went. There was an Ethiopian man, a eunuch. A eunuch means what?
Castrated.
So why in the world they do that?
So that they can't have sex with, like, the higher, because of royalty, blood, and stuff.
Well, they would put in charge of
that way they're not able to have sex with the queen and stuff because of royalty, but they don't want that bloodline being.
Well, in part, yeah, there's probably concern over the bloodline, but again, it has to do with trust.
Yeah, that too.
I don't have to worry about any hanky-panky if I take care of you.
Exactly.
And so anyhow, he is a eunuch. By the way, because he's been in Jerusalem and he went to the temple there, first he was probably excluded because he's a Gentile. You know, he's not Jewish. So there were parts of the temple that he could not go into. But even more so, he was excluded because he was a eunuch. Mm-hmm. In those days, if you had had any sort of thing like that, you were not allowed to be in the Lord's presence, okay? So this eunuch, he was, it says he was a high official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of her entire treasury. This guy's important. In charge of a lot of money, and that's why I say I can see this guy being decked out. So he had come to worship in Jerusalem and was sitting in his chariot. He wasn't standing up. I think when I was a kid, I saw pictures of him riding in the chariot standing up. But the guy was sitting, which leads you to believe it was probably some sort of a carriage that he was in, which even adds to the fact that he was wealthy, all right? He was sitting in his chariot on his way home reading the prophet Isaiah. So I don't know if he had passed. They say that because, I don't know exactly why, but oftentimes when they're reading scripture, they read it aloud. So I don't know if Philip was kind of walking on the road and this caravan comes past him and hears this guy as he's going past and he's reading from the prophet Isaiah. But he gets some distance away and sitting in his chair, he's waiting, reading prophet Isaiah aloud, and the Spirit told Philip, go and join that chariot. And again, I'm just saying for me personally, am I the only person that kind of feels out of place when you get around people of prestige?
I'm depressed, yeah. More money. Yeah, I don't fit in. I don't belong. I'm like, never mind.
I'm not here to bash them. I'm not here to bash them. I'm just saying I'm uncomfortable.
I just feel God bless them, and I'm not fitting in there.
Yeah. My mom instilled with me. She said that her dad had taught her to always remember there's nobody better than you.
That's what I.
And you're not better than anybody else.
That's what I come to recognize.
But even though we may subscribe to that, I'm just saying, do you have trouble? I will use as an illustration. There's an entourage of limousines that come down Route 2, and they're driving slowly. And you can tell this is impressive stuff. And the Spirit of God says, you go up to that limousine to talk to the person in that vehicle. I'm just asking you the question, how many of you people are going to say, that's me, buddy, I was waiting for an opportunity. Or you'd be kind of like, are you sure you want me to? And God says to him, I want you to go there. I want you to go up there and talk with that man. So that takes us through the first passage of Scripture. Let's go to the second one. Linda, you want to read it?
Sure.
Okay, page 86.
When Philip ran up to it, he heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said, do you understand what you're reading? How can I, he said, unless someone guides me. So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now, the Scripture passage he was reading was this. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb is silent before its shears, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who will describe this generation? For his life is taken from the earth. The eunuch said to Philip, I ask you, who is the prophet saying this about, himself or someone else? Philip proceeded to tell him the good news about Jesus, beginning with that scripture.
here's what I want to say. I'm going to try to make this announcement out there in church this morning. I got a text message this morning from, even though we're not involved in our association, you know, we've been kind of, for various reasons, we're not the only one, but anyhow, the guy that's in charge of it, Chuck Morrow, sent out a text message and said this coming Saturday at Mount Hill Baptist Church, they are going to do a, if anybody is interested and has time to do it, they are going to be assembling portions of Scripture. They've got, and I've got a short 1 minute video, I won't be able to show it, but they said that they are copying the text. I think one is the book of John. Have you done this in the past?
Right.
Were you a part of it? You did it?
No, I didn't do it, but...
Okay. Some of the people?
Yeah, some of the people did, and I know what you're talking about.
They are going to take portions of Scripture on paper, they're going to fold them, you know, so that it's like a copy of the Gospel of John, because it's so much cheaper than buying this stuff. They're hoping to make 20,000 copies. Mm-hmm. They were asking like for, they're hoping to have at least 100 volunteers, but it's going to run from like 9 a.m. until the video box said until 3 p.m. Chuck Morrow's hoping that maybe they can be done by noon. But they're doing these in different languages. It looked like on the one video I watched, it was like Russian or Chechenian or something. It was weird type characters. But the only reason I mention it is that people read the Word of God, even though most people just take a Bible and they sit it on their shelf. Chuck talks about when they would go to Florida that in the nightstands there were Gideon Bibles, and he would always underline Ephesians chapter 2, 8, and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves. People will read the Word of God. This was a man that was reading the Word of God, but he didn't understand.
I probably did that 25 to 30 times as we traveled. I often wondered if it had any effect.
And Sheila, you may want to take the camera and shine it over there so that the law officials could see you who marked up those Bibles 25 to 30.
Not my Bible. It was the Bible in the motel.
I know, Chuck.
Gideons are looking for you.
That's right. We're going to Gideon. Okay. People will read the Word of God, and many times they don't understand what they're reading. I'm glad that they're getting these copies out there. There are so many countries around the world where Bibles are not permitted. If you ever have time and feel so led, I don't do much publicizing. But here on this rack, in the hallway there's magazines. Some of the magazines there are the Voice of the Martyrs.
In all the years we traveled, I only found one place that didn't have a Bible. And I went down to the office. Why don't you have a Bible in this room, you know? Because the Gideons always put the Bible there.
Yes.
And he said, I guess it's the boss, whoever it was, wouldn't allow him to do it.
And a lot of these chains have taken the Bibles out. Mm-hmm. And I'm just pointing out that there's power in the Word of God, because this man is an important official and he's reading the Word of God. He doesn't understand. This passage of Scripture that he's reading from is Isaiah chapter 53. And it says, as you look in verse 32, that Scripture says, he was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb is silent before his shearers, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who will describe his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And this eunuch is reading and says, this kind of sounds sad. So the eunuch says to Philip, who is this prophet talking about? Is he talking about himself, or is he talking about somebody else? And Philip uses that passage of Scripture and tells him it's talking about Jesus. If you were to read the entire passage, and I won't take time to read the entire passage, but Isaiah chapter 53, these are some of the important parts from Isaiah chapter 53, just kind of remind you. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. That, by the way, is why I say all these depictions about Jesus being the most handsome guy. You ever notice these in the movies about Jesus? He's always a guy that kind of stands out. He's physically attractive. According to what Isaiah the prophet says about him, no. It says he had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing, nothing in his appearance that we should deny him, desire him. He was despised and rejected by man, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we have been healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So I'm not going to read the entire chapter, but that's what the 53rd chapter. And so Philip is saying, what is this talking about? And Philip says, it's talking about Jesus. It's talking about somebody who came to die to forgive you of your sins, to give you the ability to be accepted by God, which would have been very important for this eunuch. This eunuch probably, from having been around these Jewish people, felt excluded because of what had happened to him. These people were excluded. And for the first time in his life, he's hearing that God does not hold that against him. God has offered him forgiveness through faith in Jesus Christ. And so this eunuch, apparently from everything that Philip says, leads this eunuch to faith in Jesus Christ. And again, that's going to take us to the last passage of Scripture. So do you have any questions about that? Philip proceeded, verse 35, proceeded to tell him the good news about Jesus, beginning with that Scripture. All right, so there's no questions. Quickly go to the last passage of Scripture. You want to read it for us there, Sherry? Page 87.
As they were traveling down the road, they came to some water. The eunuch said, look, there's water. What would keep me from being baptized? So he ordered the chariot to stop, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him any longer, but went on his way rejoicing.
Okay.
Now, that would just blow you away.
Yeah.
You got this guy next to you, and then next thing you know, he's gone. Like, what happened here?
Yeah, that would get your attention. Would you do me a favor and look at that passage of Scripture? Do you see anything that's missing?
Yeah, I don't know why they did that. You know, how many times I've read this, I never really noticed that until I read this thing. So I had to go back and see what the verse actually said. And 37 is, if you believe with all your heart, you may. That's Philip saying that. And then the eunuch said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Okay, for those that aren't up
there,
well, and I'll explain that. In this passage of Scripture, you'll notice there is no 37th verse. You see that? The first verse that Sherry read is verse 36.
Yeah, I see that now.
And verse 38, it goes from 36 to 38. And Linda is asking, what happened to that verse of Scripture? Well, in the old King James Version, that was in there. But then they found, because we don't have any of the original copies of Scripture that were written at the time of Jesus. We don't have them. And by the way, no great works of antiquity, you don't have the original copies. All that you have are copies of copies. Well, up until really about, and I don't know exactly which one, but the Dead Sea Scrolls, which happened back in the 1930s, I think it was.
47.
Okay. Dave knows, he was around back then.
I really was.
Yeah, it was.
I was too.
It was, okay, all right. So shepherd boys near the Dead Sea were throwing rocks up in the cave, and they heard like breaking pottery. They went up there and they found copies of Scripture that had been preserved in old clay vases and that sort of thing. And when they got to looking at these pieces of scripture that came from like Dead Sea Scrolls, and there have been other ones that have found, those copies did not have that verse of scripture. They were older than the copies that were used, you know, with King James Version, or at least we think that they were. Of course, you can't go back 100 years. King James Version came out in 1608, roughly. Okay? So, it's not just that verse of scripture. For instance, a very familiar passage of scripture that is oftentimes left out in today's translations, you can find it in the footnotes, is the woman that's caught in the act of adultery. In the oldest copies of scripture that we have now in our possession, I'm talking about those manuscripts, in those oldest manuscripts, you do not find that story, which leads readers to believe that these, like this verse of scripture, it was added later by somebody else. That somebody added a verse. So there's debate over this. You will get into some churches, for instance, they will say, we use King James Version. It's not just the language that the King James Version only churches are concerned about. They're concerned about the fact that some of these verses that were part of the King James translation of the Bible are not included in today's passage. And who knows? Back when the King James Version, there might have been copies that they had that they relied upon that did have it. So they're just making you aware of what happened. Does that make sense, Linda? Am I helping to provide some clarity on that? Okay. So anyhow, there is not a 37th verse. But as Sherry just read to us, as these two, Philip and the Ethiopian, they traveled down the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, look, there's water. What keeps me from being baptized? So we don't even know how the subject of baptism came up because there's nothing in Isaiah's passage. We just have to speculate that Philip started telling this Ethiopian eunuch about John the Baptist and how he baptized people and how Jesus was baptized and that people got baptized. He might have even told this Ethiopian eunuch that Jesus said, Matthew chapter 28, 19, 20, go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them. So we just have to speculate. I've had you turn in your Bible today to Romans chapter 6 because this gives a pretty good summation of what we believe baptism is about. Romans chapter 6.
Yeah, I have a 37th verse in the New King James.
Okay, but it's King James. And there's nothing wrong with that. I personally prefer to use to keep it in there. I mean, that story came from somewhere. And just because you don't have a current copy of it doesn't mean that it wasn't in there at one time. And again, we don't have any. By the way, this is not true just of the Bible, but all of the ancient books of, you know, history, the ancient writings. We don't have the original manuscripts. And in fact, the Bible can be traced back closer to its date of origin than any of. I've got a book at home that talks about this. In fact, that book that I've referred to, Josh McDowell's Evidence That Demands a Verdict, he talks about that in the book, that the Bible comes closer than any other of the ancient writings to actually the date when they were written than any of the others. I'm talking by sometimes hundreds or even 1,000 years closer. So the Bible can be trusted. But here's what it says in Romans chapter 6. Not so much the first verse, but I'll go ahead and read the first verse because it's a reminder to us. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. King James Version says, God forbid. In other words, should we just go ahead and sin so that God can pour out more grace in our lives? So, but anyhow, that's not the focus of this. By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? What does that mean? We have said we want to die to those sins. Jesus died for our sins, and we want to die for those sins as well. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized in Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. That's why I've told you before, when we do a baptism, you are actually seeing a depiction of a death, a burial, and a resurrection. Again, that's one of the reasons that we as Baptists, we practice immersion. When you get ready to bury somebody, you don't just take like a handful of dirt and sprinkle it over. You put them totally underground. You know, it is a burial.
When my boys were born, that's what we did. And we thought that was right. Sprinkle. You know, we didn't know a difference. It wasn't until I married Bessie that I was immersed.
And there have been many people. I mean, bless her heart, Mary Conaway is no longer here. She was raised devout Catholic. And she struggled with that for years because, you know, sprinkled, baptized, or whatever they refer to it within the Catholic Church.
They refer to it as a baptism. My nephew was done that way.
And she said, but, you know, I feel like in reading Scripture, I really need to be immersed. And so she was here at the church. And so she kind of defied family. And she wasn't the first within the family. But I'm only using her because I don't think that she would be offended by it. She said, I'm going to say in her 70s. I'm not sure if she was in her 80s yet when I finally got a chance to baptize her. But she says, I believe that I need to be baptized. I need to be immersed. And so she came and she talked with me. And I said, Mary, yeah, I'd be glad to. Again, it's not the water baptism that's going to save you. But this man said, I want to be baptized. I mentioned Mary Conaway. She said, I want to be baptized. Ron Taylor, you know, he kind of lived with this fear of going underwater and drowning or whatnot. And all of his life, but he said, I want to get baptized. And I do know that there are people that, you know, I've run into in the course of my ministry. And they're like, man, I don't know. All that I'm telling you is that, according to Scripture, this is what a follower of Jesus Christ needs to do. Do I believe that a person still goes to heaven without the water baptism? Yes, I'll say it again. Yes, yes, yes. Because if you take the argument that you've got to be water baptized to go to heaven, absolutely nobody in the Old Testament is going to be in heaven. Because none of them were water baptized. None of them. So it's not water baptism, is the change that takes place when you die your old way of life and you've been raised to live for Jesus. And that's what Paul is writing these Christians of Rome. He's given us a beautiful picture of what is being symbolically represented through baptism. It's people that say, I want to die to my old way of life. I want to be raised to live for Jesus. And each person is going to have to come to their own conclusions about, you know, what Scripture says. I encourage you. It may take you a little bit of time, but there's not, I want to say that there's less than 30 passages of Scripture that talk about baptism. I've got a concordance at home before that I've kind of worked through all of those things. Go through the passage of Scripture and read it for yourself and come to your own conclusions. But for this man, after Philip had said, those that are followers of Jesus Christ are baptized. This man, dressed in his royal garbs, he says, is there anything that's hindering me from getting baptized? Because I really want to be a follower. He says, stop this chariot. Let's go get this done. And he got out of the chariot and waded out there in the water and came up a drowned rat. You know, just, I'm sure that those people around him maybe had never seen this guy look like that before. It didn't matter to him. Because he had found the person that he wanted to follow, who is Jesus. And so it says, to kind of finish up this, I know we're time for now. When they came up out of the water, verse 38. Well, go ahead and read verse 36. As they were traveling down the road, they came to some water. The eunuch said, look, there's water. What's keeping me from being baptized? So the eunuch ordered the chariot to stop. Both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water. And he baptized him. When they came up out of water, this is the part that stands out in Sherry's mind. It is impressive. When they came up out of water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away. We don't understand exactly. It could have been like he just kind of disappeared, but
it could have been just that he was led to go somewhere else to be useful for God.
It could be. I mean, there's varying translations, but at any rate, he's gone. This seems to be the only reason that God pulled Philip. And you're kind of like, why did he have Philip do that? Why didn't he get somebody else? And this is kind of what I want to emphasize to you. There are things that God has that, whether or not you're going, only you can do. I couldn't do it. I couldn't go in your place. Billy Graham couldn't go in your place. There are things that only you can do. I mean, I could read the story and I think, God, why didn't you just let Philip stay there and send some other poor Joe? God says, no, this is something that I need Philip to do. And I just want to impress that in your mind. Sometimes you might have the thought in the back of your mind, well, I'm not adequate for doing this. I need to maybe get somebody else to do it. And I just want to say to you, if God is speaking in your heart, you will have a greater impact upon that person than anybody else on the face of the earth. There are assignments that only you can handle with God's help,
of course. Yeah.
So it said the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away. The eunuch did not see him any longer, but that eunuch went on his way happier than Lord. He was like, man, oh man, I am now right with God. I belong. I've been accepted. I've been forgiven. I've been given eternal life. And that's what this life is really all about, preparing people for eternity. This life is running out. We're all getting older.
You come up from being baptized and he was going?
Apparently they came back out of the water in the Spirit of the Lord. That's, some people think that he was just mysteriously transported, almost like just kind of disappeared. Or some other people think that the Spirit of the Lord just kind of said,
I need you to go down the road to Joppa or whatever, you know, wherever he ended up.
But, yeah, we do find later on Philip shows up. The book talks about that. Philip shows up in Caesarea. He had four daughters that were involved in prophesying. So Philip is somebody that continues to make a difference in the kingdom of God because that's what his focus was. It's upon bringing people into the kingdom of God.
The miracles of God and Jesus, the Holy Spirit, those things are beyond us.
Amen.
And the doing of it is their will, what they want to do.
Amen. So, I hope that we've clarified with regard to baptism, even though the text doesn't talk about the meaning of baptism. I had to turn to Romans chapter 6. That really gives you a better picture of what baptism is all about. It's a death, a burial, and a resurrection, that you might live for Jesus. And it's a conscious decision. That's why we as Baptists have rejected infant baptism. For with infants, they didn't make that decision to follow Jesus. Somebody else made that decision. No, Scripture's pretty clear on it. I shouldn't say pretty clear, very clear. Those that are followers of Jesus make that decision for themselves. And each person needs to make that decision. And I encourage people to be baptized, scripturally baptized. The baptism, I mentioned this to you, sometimes, as I told you before, my younger brother over in Harrisburg, he was part of a church that he could not join the church because that church taught that you had to be dunked underwater three times. Baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. And you say, do people really get that technical? Yeah. I've heard of churches that will not baptize anybody in something other than running water. Like a river or a stream or something like that. They would never use a baptism because, you know, John the Baptist was baptizing in the River Jordan, and this was apparently where a spring was or whatnot. So, I mean, you could get really ticky-tack with regard to baptism. The important thing is that you are identifying with Jesus Christ, and you are basically saying to the world, I have died to my way of living, and I have now been raised to live for Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
That's why the Apostle Paul starts there in Romans chapter saying, should we go on sinning so that grace may abound? He says, God forbid. Jesus died because of sin. We've become new creatures.
The church that we go to in Florida, the preacher goes to the Gulf and has baptism.
Yeah.
And it's not always a pleasant situation. If the wind's blowing, the waves are crashing, he's come out of there banged up sometimes, but he don't do it. He doesn't.
Yes.
He takes him to the Gulf, which is not that far from the church, really. So.
Does this still hold good if you wear a swim mask?
Yeah, it does.
Well, then they can baptize me 3 times.
I had a lady one time that she said that she feels pressure. She felt pressure on her face. She couldn't get her face in water. In fact, she said even when she's showering, she can't take the shower water. And so she had to hold a towel over her face to keep that water from putting pressure on her face. I mean, we could probably sit here all day and come up with exceptions to, you know, baptism. But again, I don't want to get hung up on that. Baptism is just a demonstration of your faith in Jesus Christ, and you've died to an old way of life and now want to live for Jesus.
You want to be identified with Him? That's a way of being identified with Christ.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. So, hey, well, let's have a closing prayer. Father, we thank you for another opportunity to study your word and pray that you might help us to continue to grow and that, Father, you will use us. Not that any of us are wanting to go to a desert road this past week, but may it be a reminder to us that you do have a purpose for each one of us, and we need to be sensitive to your Spirit's leadership. You might even lead us into a situation that we're not really comfortable with, and yet we're not there for ourselves. We're there for you. And we just pray that you might help us to be faithful and to be used by you to point other people to Jesus. Thank you, Father, for this time. We ask now your blessings upon the service to follow. Have your will and way in everything that is said and done. May we grow through our time together today. May you be honored. Dismiss us. Bring us back the next appointed time. Until then, use us for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.